Now, we look at how the deer began the tale of Speckle's captivity. The four friends lived there, each choosing his own meal hours and diversions. That is, there was a deer, a mouse, a turtle, and a crow. Each day they met at the noon hour besides the lake under the trees in the thick shade, where they entertained one another in talk and discussion on various texts on the law, on economics, and other related subjects. For the wise, poetry and science suffice to keep the mind occupied. It is only for fools that time passes in sleep, squabbling and hatching mischief. One day, when Speckle failed to appear at the usual place at the usual time, the others became worried. Fear gnawed at their hearts. The friends concluded that the deer was in some sort of danger. Lightwing said, "You know very well that we too are creatures of slow gait, and for that reason it is hard for us to go in search of our dear friend Speckle." So, Lightwing had not flown too far when he noticed Speckle at the edge of a pool. He had fallen into a sturdy trap held securely by the strong pegs of acacia wood. Lightwing was quick to comfort the deer. "Oh, my friend, you should not be afraid. Not while you have friends like us. I shall fetch Goldy to cut your bonds. I shall return with him in no time." With a heavy heart, Lightwing flew back to Slowcoat, and Goldy and described exactly how Speckle lay in captivity. Then he returned to Speckle carrying Goldy in his beak. Goldy saw Speckle in his miserable plight and spoke sadly, "Dear, dear friend, you who never had a cautious mind and a sharp eye, how did you fall into such a calamity as to be put bound and fettered?" Speckle said, "If you wish to know, then listen to my story, how I have fallen into the captivity once again." "So," Goldy exclaimed, "do you mean to tell me that your honor found yourself once before bound in captivity?" So here the deer began the tale of Speckle's captivity. "Unacquainted as I was with the jump up gate, I fell into the hunter's net and got all entangled in it. While I tried to drag the net along, followed the waiting herd, the hunter came and bound my legs together. I fell on the ground, face down. The herd, seeing that there was no hope of saving me, fled and vanished. I'll tell you my story once again. While I was having fun one day gamboling, I suddenly noticed that I had lost contact with the herd. I was terribly worried, wondering where they had all gone. Looking in all the directions, I saw them standing at a distance ahead of me. They had all obviously gone ahead, avoiding a net by using the jump-up gate, and were now waiting, looking fixedly at me. Unacquainted as I was with the jump-up gate, I fell into the hunter's net and got entangled in it. While I tried to drag the net along towards the waiting herd, the hunter came and bound my legs together. I fell on the ground, face down. The herd, seeing there was no hope of saving me, fled and vanished. Or to run with the coursing herd of deer, swiftly with the wind in my face, when, oh, when will that be? The prince, oh, but this is just a little fawn, fit only to play with, and out of compassion, he did not kill me, but took me home instead, and then presented me to the prince for a pet. The prince cuddled me, gave me beautiful garlands of pearls, fine wood, clouds thundering, lightning flash. During the rains, the prince lay reclining on the couch. I heard the clouds thundering, I saw the lightning flash, and I remembered my own people. My heart was deeply stirred by a longing to see them, to be with the herd, and I recited this verse: "Oh, to run with the coursing herd of deer, Swiftly with the wind in my face, when, oh, when will I, will that be? So, who said that? Cried the prince, with fear clutching at his heart, and he looked around. Then he saw me. Ah, these words were not spoken by a human but by a deer. So this creature must be some sort of prodigy. Convinced that he was demon-ridden, he summoned the prince, summoned various sorcerers and magicians, and tempted them with great rewards, saying, whoever rids me of this torment, I shall honor him to no end. He advised the prince, furthermore, understanding my state of mind, he advised the prince, explaining, friend, now that it is the season of rains, this poor creature was only wistfully remembering his herd, and his longing recited this verse. So why does your honors de-stress yourself needlessly? The prince, hearing this, was cured of his brain fever and returned to his normal state of health. He then ordered his men to release me. Douse this deer profusely on the head with cool water. Take him to the forest where he was captured and leave him there. And his men did so. Having profusely suffered captivity once, I suffered the same fate a second time because of destiny's will. Goldy now addressed the tortoise, observing, dear friend, you have not acted wisely by leaving your fortress and coming here. Once his bonds are cut, in case the hunter is close by, Speckle can easily take one quick leap and flee. And Lightwing can fly up into a tree, while I, being tiny, can easily slip into some little crevice or cranny. Slowpoke listened and then replied, no, 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 do not say such things. Parting from loved ones, loss of wealth, who can endure this if reunion with friends is not there, a veritable panacea? At that moment, the hunter arrived, bow and arrow in hand. Right before his eyes, Goldy cut Speckle's bonds and, as mentioned before, immediately disappeared into a small cranny. Lightwing flew up into the sky and instantly disappeared, while Speckle swiftly bounded away. Never have deer been known to cut their own bonds. It must surely be fate's doing that severed his bonds. Goldy was woebegone and cried, alas, alas, what a calamity. The hunter drew out his knife, cut some spear grass, wove into a stout rope, and securely tied the legs of the tortoise together. Seeing this, Goldy said, ah, alas, what a calamity. Then, with chalice of trust and affection, a sanctuary from sorrow, anxiety and fear, who created this princeless, priceless gem of friend, a word of just two syllables, Mitra. A Goldy's grief-stricken was crying out loudly and lamenting in his manner. Lightwing, the crow, the speckle, the deer came and joined him. They said, as long as our friend Slowcoach is within sight, there is some hope of saving him. And you, dear Lightwing, alight on Speckle's branching antlers, get your claws into their interstices and pretend to peck his eyes out. Then what wicked hunter, seized by greed, thinking to himself that it was great fortune to have chanced upon a dead deer, is sure to let go of the tortoise and grab the deer. And take note, Speckle, you better plan to make a speedy escape when that wicked hunter is about to grab hold of you. Seeing, as soon as Speckle could tell from the tramp of the hunter's feet that he was very close, he rose up quickly and with a supreme burst of speed vanished into the dense forest. Lightwing at once flew up and settled on the branch of a tree, and Slowcoach, whose fetters had been cut hastily by Goldy's sharp claws, slid into the water. Goldy too scurried into a clump of reeds. The hunter looked around, rubbed his eyes, and almost believed that some magic was afoot. What on earth is happening? He exclaimed in utter disappointment and hurried to the spot where he had left the tortoise. And what did he see there but the cords with which he had tied the tortoise up, all cut into small pieces, each a finger's length. Seeing that the tortoise had vanished like some sorcerer or saint, he looked at his own body, fearful that something strange might happen to this person. With a mind filled with deep misgivings, he hurried home, all the while casting troubled glances in every direction. Meanwhile, the four friends, free from all dangers to their persons, gathered together once again and lived happily in mutual friendship and affection, feeling that they had been granted a fresh lease of life. Therefore, I say to you, if creatures going on all fours display such friendship welded through worldly wisdom, what wonder then that men endowed with so fine an intelligence should do otherwise, should do likewise. And now we come to the end of the book 2, entitled The Winning of Friends, to which this is the opening verse. Lacking resources, destitute of wealth, wise men possessed of common sense and learning are quick to accomplish their desired aims, as the crow and mole, the deer and tortoise did.